Ah, yes, gold, 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 gold. So if you guys wanna paint some non-metallic metal gold, you are in the right place. But before that, we are still gonna paint the sword. If you are just interested in how to paint the non-metallic metal gold, feel free to skip right to here, this timestamp right here. But otherwise, let's start. So right now, without the lightning, all that you're gonna need is Incubi Darkness and Ivory. You can use any other off-white that you have. I created this spectrum that will be visible on the sword. You are gonna base coat dark and then layer slash glaze to create reflections on it. For now, I have started base coating the sword with pure Incubi Darkness. All you need is few thin coats to make it smoothly covered. Hit even that recess that separates the handle and the blade. Once you get it, you will start putting reflections on those spots that you think makes sense. You should also decide how many reflections are you gonna put there. I am painting one on the left side and two on the right side. You will start progressively adding lighter and lighter paint there, covering less and less surface the lighter you go. You will many times over have to come back to the darker paint again to fix it and make the gradient smooth. For those steps when you come back, I would recommend thinning down the paint even more to make sure that the transition or the gradient is as smooth as it can be. For now, this doesn't look right at all, but in the end it will work out just fine. You know, there are always stages when I'm painting where my miniature looks like it was painted by a 6-year-old, and that would maybe even be insult to the 6-year-old, but as I'm progressing it starts to make more sense as I go. Now I'm making a reflection on the other side, and remember to not put the lightest parts of the reflections next to each other, because that doesn't look natural at all, and totally ruins the effect. You also have to decide for yourself how long the reflections are gonna be. For example, right here, these are a little bit on the shorter side, but since there is gonna be this electric effect, it doesn't really bother me. So if you made too light layer on there, you will just have to come back to a little darker one to make the gradient smoother. Right here I'm painting between the brightest and the darkest part some middle tone, but even so I will have to come back and make it smoother. Hopefully now you get the idea of what I'm doing here. This is the whole principle of painting non-metallic metal. When you understand this, it's all about making smooth gradients, high contrast and placing reflections correctly. Also, since I wanted to be a little faster, I didn't water down my paints so much. But if I wanted the top quality non-metallic metal sword, I would probably use glazing way more than layering. As I already said, I'm just adding lighter and lighter layers to smaller surfaces and making the gradient smooth as much as possible. And while I'm doing this, of course I'm focusing on creating a huge contrast between the dark parts and the reflections. Right here, the reflection got a little out of hand and I made it a little longer than I initially intended, but in the end, since I made the gradient smoother, it worked out quite nicely. Now the darker part is already smooth enough for me, I could go even further, but to keep my sanity, let's just keep it at that. Instead, I went on and made the end of the reflections even lighter for greater contrast. And whenever I feel like the gradient is not smooth enough, I come back with watered down paint that is a little darker than the brightest part and fix it. So now you got the idea, I painted the rest of the reflections off screen and really worked on making them smooth, glazing down any imperfection. It is time to highlight all the edges of the blade. Use the brightest paint that you have used when you were putting down those reflections. Here it is pretty clear that my paint is too watery and I have no control over it. Whenever you see this, just add more paint instead of water. You can also see that the edge highlight doesn't have to be done in one smooth brush stroke, as long as it is not visible. Now the middle part is a little more tricky because... God damn it. What I wanted to say is that basically you have two types of edges. The first one is sort of sharp edge, and we have no problem with that. You can just use the body of the brush and that's fine. And the other one is sort of edge like this, where it's more flat and you are really risking hitting the walls of the edge, right? So either use also the body of the brush or the tip, but either way you have to be really careful, not like me here. Let's fix it with my almighty thumb real quick, since it is still wet. So I'm doing this slowly and steadily, not using too much water so it doesn't get spilled. After highlighting the edges, this is what you get, and you can definitely leave it at this step if you want. I will still thin the middle highlight a little bit, and I will be adding a cool electricity effect. But before that, I will be doing some minor battle damage. First, paint some black lines here and there, just like this. Since black is even darker than in Kubai Darkness, it is nicely visible. And once you get it, paint a thin line around those scratches, using some of the brighter tone you used for your reflections. And that is basically how I do the battle image, just minor black lines and light paint around it. I have adjusted the black here and there and finished outlining the scratches, and now I am putting some random dots here and there around the line, mainly focusing on the corners of those scratches. And the same thing will be done even on the other side of the sword. So this is what we get, and it is finally time to paint the lightning effect. But first we gotta paint in black this little lightning rod thingy. And just be careful not to ruin your reflections and highlights. I will now highlight it using the similar way I did with the reflections, but you don't have to be that precise because we are gonna cover it in the lightning color soon anyway. Now finally, I'm gonna take Vallejo Model Color Light Green to sketch the lightning effect on the power sword and to tint the little generator thing. Try to make some irregular lightning lines, keep in mind that it should be somewhat random and those lines should be straight. You can also see that the battle damage is not really in that great of a position, but somehow I'm able to paint around it. So as you can see, planning ahead makes things way easier. Exactly the same thing applies to the other side, so just do that real quick. And I will be adding Temple Guard Blue to my light green, so it is a mix of 1-to-1. And I will start copying the tracks of the lightning, but make them a little thinner than the area that I already painted. This will make the effect brighter and therefore more easy to recognize. This part took me quite some time, but it's definitely worth it. Now I'm adding a little bit of ivory to my mix and I'm putting small dot on every place where the lightning separates its branches. Additionally, you can add even more ivory to really make it look sparkly, which is exactly what I'm doing here. On such a small area, it will take you time to place those dots. But I would recommend just keep trying instead of adding water, because you really want all the control that you can get now. This is what you get after adding more bright paint. You can see that I also added lighter paint to the main frame of the lightning, so you can do that if you want. And after some minor adjustments and added branches, this is what I got. I added quite a lot of light green combined with Temple Guard blue around the little lightning generator to make it stand out as a source. The first thing that you are gonna do is base coat all of the golden parts with Rhinoxide, as the gold always starts from brown. This step is rather simple, so just be sure not to hit any white parts. If you do hit the armor, you will have to cover it once again with Ulthuan Grey. By the way, if you wanna see a tutorial on how to paint the white armor, feel free to see my other video. So now these parts are base coated and you can already see that I have done one of the knee pads, which is what the end result should look like. And you know, I have painted it before filming because I made a step-by-step guide with pictures, so if you are interested in that, check out my Facebook and Instagram. Anyway, let's now move on and see how I got this result. But before that, I just wanna let you know that you should always think about whether just using regular metallic paint will be okay for you. Since the whole army would be kinda hardcore to paint this way, I just used regular metallic gold to paint it. But the non-metallic metal gold is definitely reserved for my important characters because it looks fabulous. So first I'm gonna cover quite large area with Mournfang brown, and this is gonna be the basis of our reflections. Since this is the first layer, you can be way more generous with it while pushing the most pigment to the middle. It is important to plan out your reflections ahead so they make sense. The reflections that will be over the edge on the other side cannot be really right next to each other, because that is not how the real-life reflective material works. And that is what I'm doing here, I'm pushing the pigment to the corner of the knee pad, and in the end, the brightest parts of both sides will not be right next to each other. If this is not entirely clear from the footage, just wait till I get to even brighter paint and it will make sense. Now I will add Aerial Yellow and Everland Sunset to my Mournfang Brown so all paints are mixed in 1:1:1 ratio. With this mix, I will paint even less area, leaving a transition of Mournfang Brown and Rhinoxide at the end of the reflection. Once again, I'm pushing the paint to the middle of the reflection as that point should be the brightest. On those transitions, the paint should be less opaque, so there is still visible some of the pure Mournfang Brown. I am adding even more paint to the middle so it stands out a little more. We still have way brighter paints coming after all. And now the front side of the knee pad will undergo the same process, but I'm gonna push the paint to the left side as that is the point that is gonna be the brightest once I'm done. Along the way, be ready to smoothen out the gradient with the previous paints that we used. We are gonna move on to pick up pure Aerial Yellow and the same process follows. Just push the paint to the middle of the reflection and make sure that those transitions are smooth. To achieve the smooth gradient, just water down the paint so it is less opaque near the transitions. I know that I keep on repeating this advice and I will be repeating it over and over again, but it is the main principle behind non-metallic metal, having smooth gradient with great contrast. I'm missing a spot near the edge here, so I'm gonna fix it later. And this is it for this layer, and I'm gonna take Ivory and mix it with my Aerial Yellow so it is mixed in 1:1 ratio. And this layer is gonna be even on smaller area, just in the middle of the reflection. I would rather be more gentle with this mix and make it less opaque, so the shiniest spot is not that large. If you still feel like you don't have enough contrast, just add more layers to the middle while keeping the gradient smooth. More layers is also preferable since you will have more control. The same thing is gonna be done right here, so do that real quick. Now this is already pretty good and you could probably leave it at that and start edge highlighting, but I'm gonna still put there more layers. So now it is finally time to start edge highlighting this knee pad with Ivory and it will really make the effect more visible. Just be careful not to make it too thick, because thinning the edge highlight is really problematic around the painted gradient. And this knee pad is pretty much finished, so now let's move on to something not so flat, like this little symbol on his left leg. Now honestly, you will use pretty much the same recipe for all parts, just the shapes that you are painting will be different. So here I'm coming to Mournfang Brown to cover most of the area, leaving Rhinoxide in the recesses. Now with mix of Mournfang Brown, Aerial Yellow and Everland Sunset in 1:1:1 ratio, I will cover even less surface, leaving darker paint just in those areas that are not exposed to light. Now with pure Aerial Yellow, I'm covering just the top of all shapes there. It is really hard to create smooth gradient on the smaller surface. So just be careful and add more bright paint whenever you feel like you need more contrast. Whenever I feel like I covered too much with my brighter layer, I make it less opaque on my wet palette and cover even darker parts to make it look smooth. And this is what I actually did with the skull in the middle. Now with some Ivory mixed into my Aerial Yellow, I'm adding yet another layer just on the top of all parts. You know, I prefer doing non-metallic metal one part at a time, because I'm constantly coming back and forth between lighter and darker shades of yellow to achieve the correct smoothness and contrast. If I painted each layer to all parts layer at a time, in the end, I would have to fix the smoothness of everything anyway. Here you can see that I glazed most darker areas with my Everland Sunset, Aerial Yellow and Mournfang Brown mix, so I made it overall brighter, since I felt like it will be not smooth enough otherwise. And after that, I'm taking Ivory that is tinted a little bit by yellow and I'm highlighting the edges. Here and there, you will see me that I'm covering too large spot with my brightest paint and I will of course fix that later with less bright layers, so it actually makes more sense. And after some cleaning up and smoothening of the layers, this is what I got. Now this might be a little too bright, but if I make the rest of the non-metallic metal parts bright like that, it will look just fine. Because after all, when you are evaluating any effect on the miniature, you have to look at the big picture and the context. So now, honestly, I'm just gonna speed up the footage and you can just watch where I'm putting each reflection on the chest and see me work, but otherwise, it is pretty much the same story. So now I feel like I pretty much talked about everything you need to know to paint non-metallic metal, so now just to quickly summarize it. So first point, you have to aim for a smooth gradient because that's how you make reflections. The second point is to create enough contrast. To make the reflection stand out, put the lightest tone in the middle of it. In a case that you are painting non-metallic metal gold, darker parts are brownish. And third point, plan out ahead where the reflections are gonna be so it makes sense. Remember that the most exposed part should be the brightest, and that's where your reflections are gonna be. And all along I am using the same paints that I used already, so you will find the list and the ratios in the description so you can try it yourself. And actually I got these specific ratios from NRM Paint, so shout out to him. By the way, you can see me push the reflection on the right side of his chest inwards instead of outwards. So this made the chest a little more interesting and it makes it look like the light is coming from the front. This will affect how I highlight every feather on this chest symbol. Okay my friends, so this is basically it. The video is almost over, you can still see the progress on screen. But yeah, otherwise, this is the video. And if you wanna help this channel out, feel free to like this video so it will spread the message. And if you wanna see more videos like this, feel free to subscribe to this channel. And yeah, see you in the next video. Bye.